Animal welfare organization PAWS has had a busy year. From the Taal eruption to the COVID-19 pandemic, their volunteers have been working tirelessly to rescue displaced creatures and nurse them back to health. And then Typhoon Ulysses struck, bringing with it more heartbreaking images of animals struggling to survive. I got the chance to speak to PAWS Executive Director Ana Cabrera about their recent rescue efforts, and here's what she had to say. Well, before we start, because I know PAWS has had a very, very busy year, and it started in January with the Taal volcano, you know, almost erupting. Let's talk about PAWS and what exactly its mission vision is first.
Okay, well, PAWS is a volunteer-based organization, and its mission is basically to promote the welfare of animals through education, campaigning, lobbying, prosecution, and even through animal-assisted therapy, because we have that, and disaster relief and response programs. Now, people have the mistaken notion that animal welfare is all about rescuing animals from the streets, and it's not. Actually, welfare is more of prevention. So what we're trying to do is prevent stray animals from being in situations in the situation where they need to be rescued, which means that all animals, we envision that they would have homes, companion animals would have homes. And there's a lot of campaigns going on, like save all the dogs of a certain pound from euthanasia. And PAWS is basically trying to promote responsible pet ownership. So we nip it at the bud, and stop the overpopulation of animals by encouraging people to spay, neuter their pets, which is tapon. Not a lot of people are familiar with that. And also to keep dogs inside their yards, because the Pinoy way of pet keeping has always been, that's why we came up with the term aspin or asong Pinoy as a substitute to askal, because we're so used to calling dogs asong kalye, because we think keeping dogs is just letting them eat in our house and then letting them go out on the street to poo, pee, and then they can come home later, they can fend for themselves. And we tell people it's not acceptable to do that anymore. Dogs should have homes, dogs should stay with a family. And this will eliminate so many problems like strays, impounding dogs, euthanasia of dogs.
Exactly. Well, you know, you also got educated, unfortunately, this year with so many unique experiences that PAWS had to deal with. But before we go into that, I wanted to talk quickly about, you mentioned volunteerism, because this is a huge aspect of PAWS, because it started in 1954 with a British lady named Muriel Jay. And her one of her first volunteers is your current president, Nita Ontiveros Lichalco. So how important is volunteerism to the cause, and how many volunteers do you have currently?
We have on our roster 200 volunteers, and there are so many applying, but the very active ones are just 30, because they have regular jobs. And it's important also to mention that this year has been a tough one for us, because our president, Nita Ontiveros Lichalco, passed away very recently, just last month. And it was she who really impressed upon us the importance of having people participate in animal welfare, that it takes a community working together in order to make things work. And it's not just about saving animals, but also about how we can change people's attitudes about animals. And when you have volunteers helping you out, then the more their eyes are open to this.
Exactly. And I'm so sorry to hear about the loss of Nita Ontiveros Lichalco. She seemed to be really the stronghold of PAWS. So perhaps you're going to be taking over, you know, that position, or, you know, just the fact that you are rallying all of the troops, because this year, I think it fell on your shoulders that you had to, first of all, let's talk about quickly before we go to Ulysses, because this is really the whole point of the interview, and the things that you've had to see and witness. The eruption of Taal, it was your first time to rescue, because PAWS usually take care of dogs and cats, but with Taal, you had to rescue horses. Talk about that, Bree.
Yes. Yes. This year has been quite an unprecedented year because with the eruption of the volcano, when we went there, we just wanted to, like our previous disaster relief or disaster response, was just go assess and then feed the dogs and the cats that have been left behind by their owners. But we found that being in Taal or Tagaytay, there were many large animals. They had farms, they had cows, carabaos. For the first time also, we've had to transport the horses from a barangay that we thought was safe from the eruption, and then they expanded the danger zone. So immediately 45 horses with 10 carabaos and cows. We thought this was not, we were not going to be able to do that because we were only used to dogs and cats. But our donors came through and we told our donors or sponsors, please get us like Manila Polo Club transport systems. And they came through. We had rich farm owners who had trucks for the large animals, and we were able to evacuate them to the Department of Agriculture Regional Field Office 4. And it was a first, and we told the government, you know, if a non-government organization like us could do this, you could also prepare for this in advance so that in evacuation situations, large animals can also be evacuated. This is important because in disaster situations, we learned that the National Disaster Preparedness Plan of the government only consists of stock replacement. For example, if they anticipate that a typhoon would hit this area, they would only prepare replacement for the X number of chickens, cows, and pigs that will die as a result of the typhoon. And that's where the budget would go. And we were pointing out that maybe we could have preventive systems and save these animals so that there would also be less like money put out just to replace them, aside from the welfare aspects.
Exactly. But in the end, they really, perhaps government sees them more as commodities as opposed to pets. And sometimes, I mean, whether it be a pig or, you know, sometimes they are really seen as pets. And it's their welfare that you're also after. Apart from that, this is not the case.
Interestingly, Lexi, we found that the reason why people do not evacuate is because they keep coming back to their pets. They have to feed their pigs. They have to go back and get their dog. They have to feed their dog. And so the government's approach should be to evacuate both the animals and the humans, because the humans have a relationship with these animals, whether sentimental, because dogs, their dogs or cats, or because they see them as their source of livelihood. If you do not evacuate the animals with the humans, you will not be able to get the 100% that you would want to save because you want to evacuate. COS has been pushing for the inclusion of animals in the National Disaster Preparedness Plans, and I think this is doable.
Exactly. Well, with Typhoon Ulysses, I'm sure you saw a lot of this also either starting to be implemented, or perhaps it, you know, the experience is more of another push to get the government to listen, to include pets in the disaster plan, because, you know, the photos that you sent were just absolutely heartbreaking. I know you were on the ground, I believe in Marikina, was it? I'm not sure exactly where you were, but maybe you can recount the story of what happened the day after Ulysses, and you've had to rescue or retrieve, actually, all of these animals.
Yes, in Provident Village in Marikina, what was heartbreaking was this was not the first time that this community had experienced flooding of this magnitude. They had this during Typhoon Ondoy, and we saw the same thing. Animals were left tied or caged. So the animals who were left in the cages or tied down, they drowned. They didn't have a chance at all. And we counted at least 30 animals, our team of volunteers. It was heartbreaking for these volunteers because they were dog lovers. They were volunteers of POS. And they came there wanting to help. And it was just too traumatic to see dogs that didn't even have a chance. And some of them had collars and tags, but they were tied down. According to residents, the waters rose so fast, they didn't really have time. But we noticed that the dogs who were treated as guard dogs were the ones that were left in the situation. The dogs that were treated as family members, they were easily included in the second floor of the houses. The owners had at least the presence of mind to let them go. And the nice thing is that we also saw about the same number of dogs that were trapped in the roof because they were able to swim to the roof. Their owners had let them go. They were able to save themselves. So the day after, or several days after, our team was just climbing onto the roof just to get those dogs down. And the minute we got the dogs down, almost immediately there were reunions because their owners were looking for them. They were going around looking for their animals already, and there were so many joyful reunions. In fact, from among the ones that we saved from the rooftops, only two or three are at the shelter, at the paw shelter now, unclaimed and not reunited with their owners. I see this as a good thing because owners really have the connection or bond. And while they may have experienced panic, they will come back. They will look for their pets. And pets are now very much part of the family.
Exactly. I mean, I can see the emotion in your eyes and in your face, Anna, because obviously I'm sure you're very happy about the reunion and these people really wanting to go back. But do you think that it's really a mix of, because when you're panic stricken and you're wanting to get out of there for fear of human lives as well, obviously, do you feel that it was a mix of that? That unfortunately some of the pets were left behind, and I'm sure that is always the case. And what can pet owners do? Because you were saying that a lot of them were caged and they probably were trapped so that they couldn't escape. How do you prevent that from happening? Because those are the ones who unfortunately didn't make it.
Mm-hmm. I think preparedness plays a big role. If you know that your place is easily flooded, you're near a river, you should always have a second floor to come up to, or if you don't have a second floor, then just maybe prepare in advance to evacuate to a relative. And it includes your pets. I mean, it doesn't really, you don't differentiate anymore that my family, human members of my family and my pet. So you will make plans in advance for your pet. Have a go bag. If your children have go bags, they have clothes there, they have food, sandwich, chocolate, or energy bars, then your dog should have at least 1 week supply of dog food there. There should be a bowl. They should have a leash. They should have a identification so that in case they get separated from you in the panic of the evacuation, they will still be returned to you. And very important, if you aren't able to evacuate with your pet, then at least let them go. Open their cages, unsnap that leash so that they would be able to survive on their own. They have the instinct to save themselves. They are better swimmers than people. And this we've seen in Provident, the dogs were able to swim up. I don't think the humans could have fared better in such a situation.
You talked about the rescue shelters and that I think with this particular situation, you only have two left with you. Is that correct?
Yes. Yes, we have one, a brown one named Rufy. And another one, I don't know what they named him. And they will, we're going to put out their photos and where we found them again. Although we did have the video of their rescue on the Paws Facebook page. But they ended up in roofs that weren't their own. So they weren't their own houses' roofs. So they probably ended up several houses away. We're hoping that there would still be reunions before the November ends. And it's also good to point out that even the humble hamper or the laundry basket could be a good tool to have. Like the ones with cats, I know that in a panic, they just put the cats there, put clothes on top, and that worked as a carrier. So if you have nothing, you have at least your laundry basket. And the humble palangana or the plastic basin, water basin, you just put your dog there and the dog floats. We've seen this in many pictures. So whatever works to help you evacuate faster, don't worry if you don't have your regular cage, kennel cab, anything that works to help you mobilize faster in a flood, that would work.
Well, we're talking also about the dogs that, let's say they are in your shelter, because eventually you also want to find them good homes. So how long will it take, let's say, for Ruthie and the other dog that you found, when they don't get, you know, they don't get taken back by their owners, how long will it take until they perhaps would like to, or you offer them to other homes that may want them?
I think it's safe to say that if after a month from our announcement, there is no one coming forward, they would be up for adoption or rehoming. And Rufy and this other dog, they're very friendly. I think they were former pets, so they would be easily rehomed. Rehabilitating them would not take very long, which is not the case for the some of the other animals that we've rescued from cruelty. Some of them have been through traumatic experiences, and so it takes several months for us to rehabilitate. Rufy and the other dog, I think they would find homes fairly quickly from the time that we announce that they are already up for adoption. People can watch out for it on our Facebook page and on our Instagram. We will announce if they are up for adoption.
I'm sure there are a lot of, you know, potential owners that will take them in and love them very much. And just to be clear, when you do your rescue operations and you see that maybe the animals have gone through a lot of cruelty and you probably do psychological tests on them, you don't necessarily put them up for adoption until they're ready?
Yes. Works? Yes. There's a misconception, like you rescue a dog today, next month it gets adopted. The before and after pictures we show people, sometimes they think this happened last week and this is her now. No, rehabilitation takes months, and the effort put both by our shelter veterinarian and our dog behavior specialist, and these are volunteers who want to spend time. Like sometimes I see our volunteers just sitting by their kennels, the kennels of these dogs, getting them to earn the dog's trust, just for the dogs to approach people. Because some dogs start out and they're very frightened of people, and for the right reasons, because they are victims of cruelty.
It's more woke now, or it's more the thing, or the more ethical thing to be able to adopt from a proper shelter, as opposed to maybe going to a breeder, because that's what everyone is saying, you know, about overpopulation as well and all of this. But I think what's important to note, Anna, is that you need to be educated first and make sure that you know exactly where you're going before bringing home a pet.
So you have to assess also yourself, because it's very much like adopting a child. It's for life. And people like nice dogs, nice puppies, young ones. But you have to also realize that the dog will grow old. They will get sick at one point or the other of their lives. So you need to be prepared for these things. If you're not, then you're better off really just getting a stuffed toy. Because everything that comes with cuteness, it will also come with illness later on, old age, arthritis. The dogs get that. And very much like us, we're okay now. And then later on, towards the end of our lives, we would have health problems. Another thing that is responsible to do is to kapon your pet. Go to your veterinarian and have the pet kapon. And male dogs and female dogs can get this surgery. And that will prevent your dog from getting pregnant or getting another dog pregnant, because that's the least thing that we would need right now. So many stray dogs. Every month, 200 dogs are put down at the local city pound. So all those lives just snuffed out for no reason. So there's no reason for us to add to that number. Just spay or neuter your pet.
Exactly. Well, final thoughts, Anna, on, I guess, because we're talking about disaster preparedness as well. and with pets. So moving forward, what would be the responsible thing to do for people, just so that, you know, because sometimes it's not top of mind, but knowing that your pet is part of your family, it has to be already.
Mm-hmm. We'd like to tell people to be ready for evacuation with their pet. Always start with that mindset that if I have to go now, of course, my children, everyone else in the family, and of course, my pet. Because with that type of thinking, then you will have the go bag ready. You will have the cages, the kennel cabs, the laundry basket, and everything you need to evacuate your pet. But please, please do not get a dog and cage it for life. Because most of those who had the perception that dogs can be caged for life as live burglar alarm systems, those are the ones that actually left their dogs in the cages and let them die there. So if you are of that mindset, then just don't get a pet. And we hope to lobby for laws in the future that should you be found guilty of abandoning an animal, you would get penalties, and you would also not be allowed to get a pet ever again. Right now, there are sanctions against pet abandonment.
Anna Cabrera from PAWS, of course, championing the needs and the importance of making sure that our pets are well taken care of, and animals in general. Thank you so much for joining us. Stay safe, and we thank you for your work after Typhoon Ulysses, especially.
Thank you, Lex.